Back in 2021, I made a video looking at a very promising battery technology that apparently had several competitive advantages over the market dominant lithium ion. The new upstart used a lithium sulfur chemistry. According to the Encyclopedia of Analytical Science, sulfur is the 10th most abundant material on Earth, available in the ocean, in the atmosphere, in the Earth's crust, and in practically all plant and animal life. Enthusiastic proponents of lithium sulfur technology suggest it could, in theory, store as much as 5 times more energy than existing lithium ion batteries. It's quite a claim, isn't it? And one that's right now probably provoking an understandably skeptical reaction in you good folks who've been patiently watching video after video from dozens of YouTubers like me over the past few years, all telling you about the next game-changing battery technology that's gonna disrupt the market. And true enough, as I discovered when I made that first video, early versions of the chemistry did have significant shortcomings. We'll have a look at what they were in a moment, but essentially they resulted in a battery that was pretty unstable with an impractically short cycle life and an inherently slow power performance. Scientists in various research facilities around the world had been working on the problem since the early 2000s, and by the time we took a look at progress 18 months ago or so, there were a couple of promising approaches in the offing. Since then, even more new scientific research papers have been published outlining yet more alternative approaches that also claim to improve performance of lithium sulfur chemistry. So what's going on then? Like, who's actually got the best technology here? And is there a genuine possibility that one of this lot might actually successfully bolt one of their batteries to anything useful in the near future, like an electric vehicle, for example? Hello and welcome to Just Have a Think. We'll try to establish whether this lithium sulfur idea has got any realistic chance of disrupting the energy storage market a bit later in the video. But first of all, let's take a quick look at how it works and what caused those initial problems. The basic principle of energy storage using electrodes and a liquid electrolyte is one that will no doubt be familiar to you. In a typical lithium-ion battery cell, lithium atoms are stored in the crystalline structure of the anode in a process the scientists call intercalation. When a load is attached to the cell, the lithium ions travel across the electrolyte and electrons travel out through a circuit. Then they hook up again on the cathode side, which in the case of an NMC battery contains minerals like nickel, manganese and cobalt, hence the name. Lithium sulfur chemistry has some very specific differences to that setup. For a start, its cathode doesn't contain any nickel, manganese, or cobalt. I'm sure you've heard all sorts of terrible things about those critical minerals in the news over the past few years. So taking them out of battery chemistries wherever possible is probably not a bad thing to aspire to. Inside a lithium sulfur battery cell, the lithium reacts with the solid sulfur to create what are known as polysulfides, which are soluble in the electrolyte and are therefore free to float across the separator and over to the anode on the other side. Sulfur itself is actually an electrical insulator, so in order for this chemistry to work at all, the sulfur has to sit on some kind of electrically conductive material. If you just stuck a solid lump of sulfur into the cell, then at best you might get some small interactions at the surface, but that's about it. What you need is for the sulfur to be highly distributed on some kind of conductive scaffold. And developers have been playing with all sorts of ideas for this in recent years, including the use of things like carbon nanofibers or exfoliated graphite, which is also a nanomaterial, or even a very exotic substance called Buckyballs or Buckminster fullerene to give it its proper name. Fully explaining what they are would take another entire video, which would probably melt my brain. But suffice to say, they're made up of 60 carbon atoms fused together into a sphere, and they're only found in laboratories or outer space. A sulfur cathode has a potential theoretical specific capacity of something like 1670 milliamp hours per gram. That compares very favorably to an NMC cathode, which comes in at only about 150 milliamp hours per gram. So it's not hard to see the attraction both for the boffins in the science department and the beam counters in the finance department. But that whopping number turned out to be a bit of a double-edged sword for our dear friends in the research labs, because it makes balancing the two electrodes much more of a challenge. Graphite is usually the go-to material for the anode side of a modern battery, and its specific capacity is about 380 mAh per gram. And that's close enough to work quite nicely with an NMC cathode, but it doesn't work quite so well with the much higher capacity of sulfur. You really need something on the anode side that's a closer match. And that's led researchers towards materials like lithium metal, which comes with its own challenges like dendrite formation, which we've touched on in previous videos on the channel. If the dendrites grow large enough, they can short circuit the cell, which is not something you want under any circumstances. That's actually one of the challenges that have hampered progress in the solid state industry, but it's apparently being worked on, and we're told it's not insurmountable. But the development challenges kept coming, like an unwanted gift that just keeps giving. The next couple of issues happen at the anode side of the cell. If it's not controlled properly, the soluble lithium sulfide coming off the cathode can do one of two very unhelpful things when it arrives over here. It can either break down in a redox reaction and flow back to the cathode, where it recombines again and starts floating back and forth in a perpetual motion known as polysulfide shuttle. That results in a phenomenon the science bods call infinite charge, where it charges at once and then won't charge anymore because those polysulfides just keep bouncing between the two electrodes. So that's quite irritating. The second thing that can happen at the anode is a reaction with whatever the anode is made of. That can cause a very unwelcome mossy-like growth known as surface electrolyte interface, or SEI. That's not ideal either, because if too much of that builds up, then your anode starts to act like an electrical insulator. Back at Monash University, one of the boffins went off on a slightly random scientific research tangent, which I won't bore you with here, but which you can find out about by jumping back to my original video. That tangential discovery allowed the team to come up with a glucose-based binder that helped prevent the SEI buildup on the anode. It turned out the lithium atoms in the polysulfide very happily combine with the oxygen atoms in the glucose molecule. So by integrating the glucose-based additive into the cathode matrix, the Monash team were able to stabilize the sulfur and minimize the anode coating problem. It also improved the web-like structure of the cathode, which opened up the matrix to provide more surface area for lithium to interact with the sulfur. Their results showed that 42% of polysulfides eventually adsorbed in the presence of glucose, compared with only 16% with previous methods. And that meant an energy density of 500 watt hours per kilogram and an increase in the battery's operational durability up to 1,000 charge cycles. All of which brings us nicely to the Silicon Valley startup called Lyten Inc., who are probably the closest to actually getting a lithium sulfur battery to market. Now, there wasn't a great deal of information available when we first took a look at these guys back in 2021, but more little snippets have filtered out in various articles and interviews in the interim period between then and now. So it's probably worth returning to their technology here to see if it still stacks up. Lyten claim their battery has the potential to reach a gravimetric energy density of no less than 900 watt hours per kilogram. That not only outperforms the Monash team, but also far exceeds existing lithium-ion batteries and even the current crop of solid-state batteries that are just starting to come to market. In visual terms, a single Lyten battery has the equivalent energy density of three typical 2170 lithium-ion batteries, and it's significantly lighter too, which is something we'll come back to in a moment. Lyten's USP is the development of a highly engineered mesoporic type of carbon for their cathode, based on their patented 3D graphene technology. That allows them to create a kind of hierarchy of pore structures that facilitates something called polysulfide caging, which alleviates the problems of SEI coating and polysulfide shuttling that we just looked at. Now, I'm not smart enough to take you through the minutiae of the chemical reactions here, but my layman's understanding of it is that it's a combination of mechanical and chemical caging structures or interactions that allow the polysulfides to do their energy release work, but then keep them where they are so they don't interact with the rest of the bulk electrolyte or the anode. Lyten reckons that this allows them to tightly control the redeposition of the polysulfides in order to release as much of that potential 1670 mAh per gram of energy as possible from the sulfur. Under Department of Defense test protocols, a Lyten cell apparently demonstrated an operational durability of more than 1400 cycles with a charge time of less than 20 minutes, which would put it right up there with the longest lasting EV batteries available today. And as a very important additional benefit, Lyten's batteries will be safer in vehicles than conventional lithium-ion batteries because, as I mentioned earlier, lithium sulfur contains no nickel, manganese or cobalt, nor the oxides that go with them, which are what drive the thermal runaway events that have plagued some electrical vehicles in the past. Testing showed that the battery could be overcharged at twice the rated voltage for the cell for over 4 hours, and its internal temperature increased by only about 10 degrees Celsius. Lyten also claimed that the interdispersed graphene and sulfur cathode architecture allows the battery to continue performing well in test temperatures as low as minus 30 degrees Celsius. And according to their CEO, Dan Cook, they'll be able to do all that for significantly less than $80 per kilowatt hour. If that's true, then it'd make the lithium sulfur battery extremely competitive compared to existing lithium ion costs. The very light cell weight that I touched on a moment ago has obvious advantages for electric vehicles, but perhaps more importantly for objects that have to fight against gravity, like drones, for example, or even electrically powered planes like this one from Israeli company Eviation, which, by the way, has more than $2 billion of pre-orders already. With a lighter battery on board, the flight distances of these planes will be significantly enhanced. So when will we see these batteries actually hit the market then? Well, Lyten are up and running already, actually. On November the 4th, 2022, they announced their first 3D graphene fabrication facility located at their headquarters in San Jose, California. And they plan to reach volume production of lithium sulfur cells within a couple of years. Lyten certainly look like they could be in prime position to corner the market if they can get a wiggle on and get volume production up and running in the timescales they're projecting. But there are plenty of others trying to find that holy grail of performance versus cost and longevity. At least three new research papers have been published just in the last year or so, each with their own take on how to most efficiently and effectively eliminate some of the issues we've discussed today. So I guess Lyten will need to keep a careful eye on the competition in the coming years. That's it for this week. A huge thank you, as always, to the fantastic team of channel supporters over at Patreon who literally keep this channel running and help me produce videos that are free of ads and sponsorship messages. And an extra special thank you to the folks whose names are scrolling up the screen here, all of whom celebrated an anniversary of Patreon support in January. If you feel you could support the channel too, then for about the price of a coffee each month, you now get early exclusive access to all my videos so you can provide feedback before I publish them on YouTube. Plus, you'll get regular exclusive extra content from me, and you'll be able to directly influence the video topics we choose via monthly content polls. And of course, if you found this video useful and informative, then you can really help us by subscribing to the channel and hitting the notification bell. And make sure you drop down the menu and select all notifications too. Otherwise, the YouTube algorithm has a habit of forgetting to let you know when new videos arrive. As always, thanks very much for watching. Have a great week, and remember to just have a think. See you next week.